especially happy to introduce our today's speaker, Viktoriya Sereda. I have, they sent me Viktoriya's CV and I looked at it and I thought the first page and I didn't go till the very end and I pressed print and it was printing and printing and I had to put more paper. So eventually I got, I don't know how many pages, I'll try to summarize them in this few minutes. Viktoriya comes to us from the from Ukraine, from Lviv. She is associate professor in the Department of Sociology at the Ukrainian Catholic University. And I was trying to do the count of your degrees, and it looks like there are two master's degrees and one candidate of science degree. So Viktoriya started as a historian, and then at some point in her career, I don't know what exactly happened, but she went into sociology. In the year 2000, she received MA degree in sociology. The title of the dissertation was Legacy of History in Polish-Ukrainian Ethnic Stereotypes. And then 1 year later, there came another master's degree, now in science, I understand. And it was from the University of Edinburgh in Scotland. The title of the dissertation, Regional Historical Identities and Integrity Discourse in Ukraine. And then 4 years later, there came a candidate degree in Ukraine with the dissertation on regional historical identities and their influence on political orientations in Ukraine. So you see that really Viktoriya covers a lot of space in terms of academic interests. She is author of numerous academic publications, including co-author of the textbook for, I understand, Ukrainian universities, which is called Sociologiya Mista, Navchalnyy Posibnik, which was published in the year 2010 in the city of Donetsk, in Ukrainian. And Viktoriya is also co-author, co-director of numerous sociological projects, and I mentioned just the most recent ones that are very closely related to the reason why Viktoriya is here and also what she is going to talk about. So she is co-author of sociological project Present Ukrainian Refugees, Main Reasons, Strategies of Resettlement, Difficulties of Adaptation, funded by British Embassy and Ukrainian Peacekeeping School. This is the year 2014-2015, 2015-2016, another project, Donetsk, Kherson, Kyiv, Lviv, Zhytomyr, Sociological Analysis of Group Identities and Hierarchies of Social Loyalties. There was a project on Region, Nation and Beyond, an Interdisciplinary and Transcultural Reconceptualization of Ukraine, which was funded by the Danili Foundation and Swiss National Foundation. And that project had a number of stages, and it was the most amazing one in a sense that the number of people that were polled was 6,000. That's three times as many as normally you get information from Ukraine in terms of sociology. And even more importantly than that, Viktoriya actually agreed to share that with us on a number of levels. She is now working as a GIS MAPA fellow. She is a worthy continuator of the work that was started by Nadia Kravitz, whom you all well know. And Viktoriya's today's presentation is very closely related and connected to the work that she started as part of that Swiss and Danili Foundation funded project, and what she is doing here for MAPA, the Digital Atlas of Ukraine. And before I turn the floor to Viktoriya, I want to use this opportunity also to gain a little bit more publicity for our MAPA project. So the number of modules is growing in the MAPA project. As you probably know, we started with the Holodomor, with famine, which is growing. We have a number of other modules, including the one dealing with Kiev and Rus and marriages, intermarriages between Kievan princes and rulers of Europe. There is another on the settlement during late medieval period and early modern period of Podolia, of this all-important border, moving frontier between between settled population of Ukraine and the steppe areas. And we are now in the process of preparing a new module that I hope will be launched maybe within next few weeks, maybe within months and a half, and that's on the politics of memory in contemporary Ukraine. And again, this is part of things that Viktoriya is going to talk about. So again, welcome, and we'll all look forward to your presentation.
Thank you very much. I would like to thank, first of all, Harvard Ukrainian Research Institute for supporting my research, and especially to MAPA team for many hours of very challenging discussions, and to all of you, because I believe that we will have very productive conversation today about what is happening to Ukraine recently. And when I'm talking about remapping, when I've chosen this word, because I would be talking about three slightly different phenomena combined in one. So I will be talking about comparison of official historical narratives and symbolic recodification of public spaces, both on national and local levels. I'll use MAPA project data to reveal cross-regional patterns. So I will try to map this regional or cross-regional patterns in people's attitudes towards history. And I'll be talking also about mental mapping, the processes of renaming, reimagining past, and understanding meanings of symbolical meanings of different urban, rural spaces in Ukraine after the Euromaidan. My presentation will have three major parts. In the first part, I'll compare very briefly processes of mapping of spaces of memory at macro, at the level of official historical discourses, meso, local politics memory, and micro individual perceptions levels before and after Euromaidan. In the next part, I will analyze, as I said, cross-regional patterns using MAPA project tools. And in this part, I will focus on the main markers of the past which experienced the most changes. And also, we'll look whether there are any regional specific in those shifts. And finally, I will briefly discuss peculiarities of symbolic rearticulation of spaces under the questions such as Crimea, occupied Donbass territories, and influence of the massive resettlement affected population on reimagining historical past, because they are quite actively involved in those processes. I will not focus very deeply on the politics of memory, because this is not my subject. But I need to at least briefly sketch what was happening in Ukraine before Euromaidan. So if we are looking at the Yanukovych's official speeches, we see that in comparison to Yushchenko, number of speeches radically drops. Repertoire of historical and figures or events shrinks, again radically. And complex narratives with interlinked events or personalities, because within one presentation of Yushchenko, you can have the whole history of Ukraine, now is practically absent. And quite often, Yanukovych at the very beginning uses his speeches, which are supposed to be devoted to historical event, actually just to say one sentence and then to start to say, you know, my team is doing great, they are have this success in economics or in some other spheres. But by 2013, actually, situation radically changes. Now, historical speeches outnumber non-historical, so history comes to be important for him. talks about history and in non-historical speeches. So even if he is presenting to Supreme Council or some other events, he would include some historical elements in his speeches. And a repertoire of historical events and figures remain quite narrow. And actually, if we look carefully, we see that all his presentations or all his historical imagination is focused on two nodal points, which is baptism of Rus and Great Patriotic War, or in some cases he calls it Second World War. Since the Great Patriotic War is in focus, what we see that by 2013, 80% of his any type of speeches would have some elements or some mentions about Great Patriotic War, and 40% of them were directly devoted to this topic. And he also joined this competition of victims because he says he starts with 7.5 million of Great Patriotic War victims of Ukrainian population. And then this number grows steadily till 10 million. I think this is somehow to outnumber or gave the similar number as Yushchenko was using for the famine. If we are looking at the narrative, we see also changes. First of all, Onanupa completely silenced. He never mentions it in any context, positive or negative. Holocaust mentioned only as in a separate box, only on International Day of Holocaust Victims. All other speeches where he talks about Second World War are not including this. And very similar situation is with Crimean Tatar deportations. And actually, when you're at the Memory Day, when he talks about this, he says some 1940s events, so we don't even know when exactly and why it was happening. And what we also find very interesting that we have constant cross-references to Rus baptism. So if he talks on the Second World War, he'll mention that we won because of the baptism of Rus. And if he talks about baptism of Rus, then he would mention, and this was such a great event which lasted till, so they are cross-referenced constantly. If we are looking at historical figures, he uses only 18 names, and only seven of them were named more than once. And the major actor are veterans for him. And the other important figure would be Volodymyr the Great, and also those who belong to old Rus period, such as Askold, Olga, Igor, Sviatoslav, Yaroslav. From the Kozak period, he mentions only Khmelnytsky, Orlik, and Mohyla. And from the later period, only Shevchenko. So later personalities, again, were often mentioned in the context of Kiev and Rus heritage. So even if he talks about Shevchenko or Khmelnytsky, those heroes are included in the narrative about Kiev and Rus. If we are talking about the symbolic recodification of public space, what we see a particular balance between the government on the one side and local administration and population. So government might decide to change certain things within the local spaces, but local administration have enough power to overrule any decrease or any changes. And this is very important because they would be elected as a local representative, so they would not go any or do anything what won't please the population, local population. And it is also for them very important to preserve the status quo, because then they can manipulate, if there are any regional differences, to mobilize the electorate. If we are looking at the number of monuments, that these are five the big cities of Ukraine, which would be dismantled from 91 till 2013, we see that in Donetsk this were 0%, in Odessa 3%, in Kharkiv 9%, but actually only one was dismantled with some public discussion, and all other just disappeared overnight because the mayor needed this space for his building construction project. And if we are looking at Kyiv, Kyiv would have dismantled only 9% and only 18% in Lviv. Why? Because rest of the monuments could be rearticulated. So they were usually devoted to Soviet Ukrainian scientists, actors, so they could be rearticulated in a new narrative. Number of new monuments erected by 2000 till 2013, and we see again that the smallest activity is in Donetsk, only 17, the highest in the capital, 81 new, and all other big cities are more or less even in numbers. If we look at the representations of past to which those monuments were devoted, we see that different cities would have slightly different patterns. So the red one is Lviv, so we only have monuments devoted to Ukrainian narrative or to victims, and a small number of monuments devoted to different types of national minority members. But here, all cities have the same pattern. And if we are looking at the Kyiv, Kharkiv, and Odessa, they have more or less the same pattern. And again, outlier would be Donetsk, because the biggest number of monuments erected to victims, and this would be the victims of the Great Patriotic War, are in Donetsk. Many experts stress that at that time Ukrainian society did not have integrated commemorative space, and we asked our respondents in the survey whether they would be willing to erect monuments too, and we've got a list of heroes, and we see that actually Hrushevsky gets the highest point, but still this is not a majority of population. So if we are talking about the period prior to Euromaidan, it can be characterized by attempts of active manipulation of past by Yanukovych government for the purposes of political mobilization of its opponents, with the focus on Great Patriotic War and baptism of Rus, which could easily be incorporated into different historical narratives such as Ukrainian, Soviet Ukrainian, Russian, Russian Imperian, and so on. Instead, regional elites tried to preserve status quo or successfully resisted any changes if they were unwanted, while population took rather very passive position of bystanders. Urban landscapes were used for different representations of past, Ukrainian, Soviet Ukrainian, Russian imperial minority narratives, which coexisted quite often peacefully, but had little impact on the development of agreement within the society about what are the most heroic or shameful pages in the history of the country. And they were rather leading to the segregation of memory. Each community would celebrate something different and they would not overlap. Post-Euromaidan Ukraine. During the Euromaidan and its aftermath, the public activism reached its peak. New spontaneous grassroots local initiatives aimed at the creation of new heroic cult emergent among many other initiatives. Its support still would vary in different parts of Ukraine, since Euromaidan itself had not equal degree of support in all oblasts. Very soon, this heroic narrative was complemented by the other, more powerful one, associated with the Russian aggression in Donbass, since ATO directly affected much wider circles of Ukrainian population. For the first time, Ukraine has started to form a cult of heroes commonly accepted, and particularly in all regions of Ukraine. However, we should remember that this cult also had some limitations, because it was excluding those who have other interpretations of events. In parallel, Euromaidan, as any political or social upheaval, provoked an active revision of past in search for legitimization of one side and delegitimization of the other, The main tensions arose between the Soviet representation of the past and Ukrainian nation-centered narrative, especially about the interpretations of heroic myths of the Second World War, intensified by Yanukovych politics of memory. In public spaces, it resulted, first of all, in so-called Leninfall, where spontaneously or not so much Lenin monuments were dismantled. And these are a few examples of this new commemorational practices. This is Avenue of Heroes of Heavenly Hundred. This is Wall of Fame, so-called, in front of Oblast, Dnipro Oblast administration. And when Euromaidan started, people were just bringing pictures of Heavenly Hundred and lighting candles there. And gradually, the space was overtaken by commemorative pictures devoted to those who were killed in ATO. So soldiers or their families or their friends or combatants are coming there, placing new pictures and lighting candles. And this is grassroots level commemorative space. Another example, again, in Dnipro, which is very interesting, is the ATO Museum, which also started as a grassroots initiative. And very interesting is its location. This is the second biggest diorama of the Second World War in Europe. And next to it is open air, is located this new open air museum to ATO. And here you have weapons from the First World War and Second World War. So we see how those narratives are included and merged. And as I said, this is also grassroots initiative. What's happening to the symbolic recodification of public spaces? This spontaneous process of rural recodification of rural and urban spaces changed its character after the Supreme Council of Ukraine issued very controversial decommunization law in April 2015. They intensified process of undoing Soviet symbolic markers, but reversed character from the top to the bottom. So if at the beginning it was more or less spontaneous, now this was the government which could not be overruled by local administration. Why? Because according to the law, a local administration or local community was given certain time to change name and or to do something with those markers. And if they didn't, then Supreme Council can decide for them. So here we see that actually we have a misbalance between this tripolar relations, state, civil society, and population. If you look at presidential official speeches, we see also that this narrative changed. So historical speeches were more or less equally with the number of non-historical. The repertoire of historical events or figures was still quite narrow. But what is very important, Poroshenko downplays Soviet historical narrative in his speeches. For example, he is already silencing three Soviet holidays which are still are part of Ukrainian holiday calendar. He is re-emphasizing and recoding meaning of two holidays which existed in Ukraine since 90s but were never celebrated, but just very marginal ones. And he introduces new commemorations devoted to the Day of Dignity of Freedom and also to Heavenly Hundred. But what is the most important, if you look at his speeches, all historic and heroic narratives are linked to Euromaidan and ATO. If we are talking about Great Patriotic War, we also see a lot of recodification or remapping. First of all, the main emphasis is on the main ACE, a Day of Remembrance and Reconciliation. Importance of May 9th is very much downplayed. Reconciliation of Red Army and UPA veterans through ATO. He says that now you should reconcile because your grandchildren are fighting together in ATO. And he also tries to shift completely the meaning of the Great Patriotic War, because he says Ukraine's Great Patriotic War is ATO. So now I will try to, using our MAPA project, I'll try to look how all this, what was happening on macro and meso level, how it is presented, or how what are the attitudes of people. So the background map is the index of Ukrainian holiday. The darker is, the more holidays are celebrated. And in red, this is the day of Ukraine's defenders. This new holiday, which was in Ukrainian calendar since 90s, but was never celebrated. And what we see actually, that since it's absolutely new recodification, it is more or less accepted in almost all regions of Ukraine. And in green, we see Freedom and Dignity Day, the day which is celebrating beginning of the Euromaidan. And it is less successful, but still it is celebrated by people in practically all regions of Ukraine. Now, here we have the question whether people would support, and this yellow chart means that they support. Red would mean they do not support. Green would mean they are indifferent, and dark would say that they don't know, they cannot answer. And the question is whether they would support celebration of 8th May. This is a new holiday which is introduced in Ukraine. And again, we see that the only one oblast of Ukraine where people are against introduction of this is Kharkiv. And in all others, we see that situation more or less is either equal or of more support than not support. The other question was, do you support renaming 9th of May as the day of victory of the Nazism and in the Second World War? So the main change is here, the name from Great Patriotic to the Second World War. And here we see that in this case, we are talking about old holiday, and we have attempts to recodify it. But actually, resistant to an old recodification of old holiday is much higher. We see that the positive answers are limited only to this part of Ukraine, and others are rather do not support this idea. We also asked in 2013 and 2015 our respondents whether they consider Famine as a genocide, and total majority said yes. Of course, the question is what they understand under the genocide, but I think this phrase is already in historical memory. And what I try to do, I try to compare the total direct famine losses in Ukraine produced by HURI MAPA project to the support of the statement. And what we see first of all that the greatest support is in this part which is missing in this map, because it was here. But we also have this part of the Ukraine, which has the greatest losses. So we probably could talk about two types of memory. One would be a national myth, newly acquired. And in this part of Ukraine, we could say about post-memory. And we also, these charts demonstrate the answer, negative answer to this question. So the number of people who do not support the statement that Famine is a genocide, And what we see that even in those parts of Ukraine which where it is not supported, that numbers of people who do not support are gradually declining. The main shift in our survey occurred actually to the statement about the support of recognition of NUPA as the fighters for Ukraine's independence. In 2013, we see that minority was pro and majority was against, and now we have a reverse situation. And it is very interesting to look where at the regions where those shifts occurred. So this is the map for the support. And we see that we have, except traditional Galicia and Volhynia, now we have also central Ukraine, which is the most shifts are happening. And we can compare this question to the other one, which was asked at the very end of 2015 by Razumkov Center. And they asked, as it was formulated in this decommunization law, recognition, and then you have the huge list of what they support as the fighters for independence. But actually, if we look regionally, the main shift or main support zone still remains the same. This would be Galicia, Volhynia, and central Ukraine. We asked the same question about willingness to erect monuments, but we added two positions, and what we see that finally we've got two positions, which is Heavenly Hundred and Atop participants, which unite country. And we can look at the level of support for Hrushevsky Mazepa. And here we see that support for Hrushevsky, which is in blue, and Mazepa, actually grew practically in all oblasts of Ukraine. We asked whether they will be willing to erect monuments to Bandera or Lenin, and we see that again increase in support for Bandera monuments again happening in the same zone. This is green and dark, this is Bandera, and in red we have Lenin monuments, and we have decrease in support, and this decrease is happening in this part of Ukraine. And finally, we also asked the people about the monuments to Heavenly Hundred and NATO soldiers. And here we see that they are support everywhere, and to ATO soldiers more supported, and I explain why. And the oblasts of Ukraine which do not support are actually those oblasts which are very close to the contact zone. And we asked in 2013, we asked our respondents whether they support, are willing to support renaming streets. And the ground map is actually the answer to the question, negative answer to the question. These are oblasts which do not support renaming of streets. And on the top of this, I've placed a number of renamed toponyms. This data just appeared as a process of decommunization. This was from the Institute of National Memory. They were just rebuilt. So we can compare unwillingness to change names of toponyms with the number of toponyms which were actually changed. And here, of course, we have this outlier zone. And very similar thing, we can compare number of support for the dismantling Lenin monuments. We asked this question one month before the decommunization law was accepted, and this is the actual number of Lenin or Soviet leader monuments which were dismantled till the end of 2016. So again, we see that actually those oblasts of Ukraine, which mostly disagreed with the statement, right now are facing the most active recodification of their local public spaces. Finally, I want to talk a little bit about the annexation of Crimea and the following Donbass armored conflict. And we have two themes. One is symbolic rearticulation of spaces, and the other very important one is massive resettlement of population, which is producing displaced cultural spaces. So first of all, in our interviews, we found that both sides, combatants from Ukrainian voluntary units, are talking about our lands. We are fighting for our lands. But if we are looking how those our lands are described, usually the focus is on existing borders. Another theme which we can trace is symbolic marking of public spaces as Ukrainian. And this is quotation from the interview. When I arrived to there, Zaporizhia, every second balcony had Ukrainian flag on it. Every third shop, small shop, was painted into Ukrainian flags. It was really scary for me. And actually what happened, the person returned back to Donetsk. Pro-Russian rebel militants are also using notion of our land and fighting for our land, but in this case they appeal to imagined historical projects or regions. They talk about Novorossiya, Little Russia, Russian world, and all those projects do not have fixed borders. So those borders can be stretched anywhere. Another very important thing is the theme of sacralization of space by appealing to the victims of the Second World War. Dede Vojevali, our grandfathers fought here, died here, and this space is sacred. And if space is sacred, it's almost impossible to give it back or return. We have to fight till the end because this is a sacred space for us. So if we're talking about Crimea, we also have the notion of our land, and the main motif is final return, presented in different murals and public space agitation. The common themes would be changing Ukrainized versions of the city of street names, marking spaces as our by flags, visual aids with elements of historical legitimization, and incorporation into contemporary Russian through Soviet or Russian imperial, if we are talking about Crimea, historical narratives. And the central nodal point would be, again, the Great Patriotic War. So here we see how the name of Donetsk is changed. And also this is the same, it's a Soviet name, but this is Ukrainian version of the name, and now we have Russian version of the name, so streets, cities are being renamed. And these are different billboards with elements of Great Patriotic War as a nodal point in Donbass. And again, the Victory Day is extremely important commemoration day, and in 2016 in Donbass they adopted a new law which says about the commemoration of the Soviet people's victory in the Great Patriotic War, regulating activities and commemorational rituals connected with this holiday. And here we have again this Great Patriotic War theme in Crimea. And the quotation from the person who, the refugee, who went from Lugansk to Tumen. Have you ever heard words Russian world? What does it mean for you? I like 9th of May. You know, after living over 20 years in independent Ukraine, where we here in Russia participated in 9th of May, and I never saw in my life so many happy people, kids, adults, youth. They are all happy that 9th of May is their holiday. It might sound pathetic, but I lived many years in Ukraine, but I never saw something like that even on TV. So the importance of this commemoration is stressed. And as I said, there were a great amount of people who were displaced, and this map is actually demonstrating where they went. And as you see, on Ukrainian territories, we have roughly, these calculations are very difficult to make precise, roughly 1.8 million of people who fled to Ukraine. And these are numbers of people who went to Russia, Belarus, Poland, Slovakia, Hungary, Romania, and all other countries. So actually, all together, we can talk about more or less 3 million of people who are changing their living places. And some of them are claiming they feel lost and unrooted. How to explain this? I'm neither here nor there. In general, because I'm from Donbass, now I live here in Odessa, I'm an orphan in this sense. When you are growing up in one place, you absorb something at the level of traditions, culture. You understand that this is a church, there was a particular school, right here where partisans, she is referring to the Great Patriotic War partisans, it shapes you. You are an information carrier. When you are coming here, it is a complete black hole. The other respondents are saying that they are actually quite actively exploring the new spaces where now where they are living. One of the respondents says, he says, let's have a tour around Kherson. And I bought a new guidebook and we went on a tour. And later I started to read more deeply. You never know, it might be useful. I was reading on internet about Kherson and about its castle. So coming to a new spaces, and which they are actually quite often unknown to the people, they are trying to explore them. And they are exploring them also from the historical point of view. I was simply walking all the day. If I liked a street, I was admiring architecture, reading memorial plaques. I was studying. No, I was admiring who was living here. And people are also talking that this process of resettlement caused a lot of reconsidering of past for them. It started to come out, genocide, when famine was in 1933. It is for the first time here I learned about it. I didn't know that it was before. My grandmother then told me that in 1929 there was a great famine in Crimea. It started to come out. Another quotation. Till this year I didn't know that Volyn, I taught history of Ukraine for 4 years at school. There were just a few lines in a textbook. But when you come here, you begin to understand that history might have a different interpretations. I would highlight Khmelnytsky. He wanted Ukraine to be united. Who else? Bandera. My knowledge of history is very poor. Bandera, he also, I don't know, but they say he wanted to unite united and independent Ukraine. I don't know history well. History is so twisted. We were taught in school completely different things. We knew about Bandera that he is a negative hero, but it was the Soviet Union at that time. At that time, Lenin and Stalin were good people. Now they are negative. You see, we are changing in line with history as it is presented to us. Now it is more truthful. And finally, we also have some reports about the attitude to decommunization. We were brought up that Lenin We were giving pins with Lenin, monuments was an idol, and I thought it is normal at that time. When they started to demolish monuments 2 years ago and before, I could not understand it. Whom was this iron idol bothering? I started to read literature, newly opened new documents. My colleague, you know, his grandfather fought at the Great Patriotic War. She gave me this information. And he was absolutely sick person. Now I understand that that all this had to be done. I tell you, when we started, they told us that Mazepa betrayed. From the other side, now I live here, I live on Mazepa Street, and I can tell nothing. So to summarize all what was presented, I would say that inhabitants of Ukraine are more willingly to accept new cults of heroes as well as new holidays than the alteration of meanings of existing ones. Changes in attitudes to already codified holidays, events, or personalities differ in scope. In general, the Soviet and Russian imperial representation of past are gradually losing their support, and Ukrainian one is gaining. But there are regional variations. The turbulent events of the 20th century, and especially the Soviet myth of the Great Patriotic War, are at the core of remapping spaces of memory. The attitudes associated with symbolic alteration of the Soviet myth of the Great Patriotic War and acceptation of such nationalist heroic markers as Bandera and UPA, typically limited to Galicia and Volhynia, are now gaining support in the central Ukraine. Growing support for more neutral historical markers from the Ukrainian national narrative as Grushevsky, Chernobyl, Femain is observed in all over the Ukraine. Also, Kharkiv, Donetsk, Odessa and Mykolaiv regions demonstrate the lowest dynamic. We also witness appearance of new commemoration practices and spaces. We have a trend of merging stories of Euromaidan and ATO, subordination of other narratives of the past to this new story. Official and local historical narratives are mutually actually reinforcing and more easily accepted than a recodification of older practices. Our research demonstrated that the process of remapping of spaces in memory in post-Euromaidan Ukraine is actually extremely intensive. It is happening on all levels of society and involves very diverse social actors. At the same time, Ukrainian government has to respond to two mutually actually almost exclusive tasks. One, attempt to build ethnically inclusive narrative for Ukrainian political nation. And from the other, the need to respond to Russian ethnically focused and anti-Ukrainian propaganda, which includes a lot of historical argumentation. And under such circumstances, it is, I think and I believe, important to use all possibilities for open public discussion about the past and include in this dialogue as much as possible civil society to moderate it. Thank you for your attention, and I allow myself very little teaser. This is a new module of the MAPA project, which is called History and Identity, and what it will allow you to do to choose base map, for example, Ukrainian holidays index, the number of people are celebrating, and then you can choose holidays, for example, 8th of March, Women's Day, support for this, and look for some correlations and start to think or maybe produce new hypotheses about what is happening with Ukrainian memory and identity in Ukraine currently.
Thank you very much. This is really fascinating, and especially the fact that, again, soon the that module of MAPA will be available not just to present the results of Viktoriya's research and research of others, but also as a tool for yourself to ask questions, to explore, and to come up with the answers that maybe not all of them we would approve, but once we release these databases and give you this tool, you're really free to make whatever conclusions you want to make. So I guess I stop here, and I'm happy to invite questions or comments to Viktoriya. Yes, Matthew.
It seems that the Great Patriotic War is kind of a myth, the main foundation myth for those people who still identify strongly with the Soviet Union. And it was very interesting that the ATO Museum in Dnipropetrovsk was built in the same place as the diorama of the Great Patriotic War, in the same way as the Museum of ATO in Kiev is inside what's now called the World War II Museum and what was previously called the Great Patriotic War Museum. Do you think that there's a kind of deliberate attempt to replace, both kind of symbolically and through the use of locations, the Great Patriotic War myth with the new ATO myth?
I don't know about Kyiv. I haven't seen it, so I cannot comment. I've been in Dnipropetrovsk. So I would rather say that they are trying to include it in narrative, changing symbolical meaning, like this is our new great patriotic war, but not diminishing the role of the previous one, at least how it is presented in Dnipropetrovsk.
So they're trying to keep kind of both at the same
time? Merging instead of replacing.
Okay.
So thank you very much. That was really great data. And I have lots of questions, but I'll start with one and then maybe I'll ask later a few more. So what I understand the causal error of why we see the shifts happening is really change and shift in elite discourse. Is that correct? In terms of the movement of more national, one could say more Ukrainian myth towards the center of Ukraine and spreading somewhat on some of the questions into East and South has to do, in my understanding from your presentation, in terms of the way in which Poroshenko and the elite has repackaged some of these events. Is that correct? Or if you could explore a little bit on the causation of the shift that you're seeing that's happening in remapping or re-identification, as you see things?
I would say this is more, it would be more reverse, because as I said, as Euromaidan started, there were a lot of public activism and a lot of grassroots level activities, which later were taken over by either local official discourses or national. For example, first we have this auto museum, and then local oblast administration gives some money to even expand it, and then we would have Poroshenko who would come there and make some speech and bless the space. So in this case, I see that in the previous time, we would have more attempt to impose official narrative and then more or less passive situation at the bottom. And here we have the opposite relationship. First,
how do
we
you
have
explain then the poll results, the opposition, seeming opposition. So on the one hand, you have this grassroots movement in the center and the south and the east, but at the same time, the poll results that you show, there's a lot of opposition to Lenin, Opad, and the various other things. I'm just
because, as I said, this if we are talking about two different sets. One is new commemorational practices, and they are much more accepted. So people are much more willing to accept new practices than to get rid of what they were taught or what they thought about. And here, the support shrinks only to the western and central part of Ukraine.
Mm-hmm. Yes, please.
I wonder whether there are some nuances in what you presented, which, by the way, is absolutely fantastic material, both in the center west and the east that I found actually sort of, you know, interesting to explore. And in the center, it seemed to be on several occasions that Zhytomyr's oblast seemed to be something of an outlier. I don't know whether it's just my imagination or whether there's something to it. And if so, I wonder whether you could, you know, give us a clue about what is going on there. And in the east, both, of course, Luhansk and Donetsk oblasts are divided between areas under Ukrainian government control and those in the Russian-oriented areas. Of course, there are people who travel between those two. They may work in one place and go someplace else to collect their pension, or they visit family or want to examine their properties or whatever. And I wonder whether in your surveys you were able to isolate these people with exposure to what is going on both sides of this border, and see, you know, whether there are any special nuances in which way they may be tending in terms of the remapping and rethinking of the historical memory.
As of Zhytomyr, we also discussed this, because it really seems, and this is not only in our survey, I know several others where Zhytomyr will also be outlier, and we actually used Nadia's data set with statistics trying to look for the explanation. But if we are looking from the point of view social demographic, all these oblasts are more or less same. So it's very difficult to find a direct causal explanation. And the hypothesis is that this is more a long-duree historical processes. But as a sociologist, I do not want to speculate on them.
May I jump in and explain what our theory is, whether this is true or not, one would have to look into that. But again, the idea comes from Ostap Sereda, so we are, this is a family
business,
a family project and involvement in brainstorming of what that means. Zhytomyr is part of Volynia area in general, which was, of course, the hotbed of Russian nationalism before World War I. So people sent, most of the people who were sent to the Duma were either members of the Soyuz Ruskova Naroda or organizations like that. So the question is then why Volynia is voting differently from Zhytomyr, and the explanation probably, again, historical, would be the interwar period. And so in a sense, we have this part of Russian Volynia that never went through the nationalization processes of interwar Poland, which is still hanging there, and in that sense, we can see some elements of that tradition going on. But again, that's not a scientific kind of fact. Of course, we now know that there are alternative facts, so that's I guess one of those. Sorry.
Mm. And as of different sites, we had problem with conducting interviews in Crimea. So in the project I'm presenting, actually we plan to conduct interviews with those who once go somewhere and then return back, and we didn't manage to get any of them because people refuse to talk on the tape recorder. We have only very, very few interviews with people who are from the so-called DNR, LNR territories. And again, they would rather talk about the situation before everything happened than reflect on what is happening currently. And I think partially because they're afraid of situation. So they would talk more about the most positive historical event they name would be actually Euro 2013 and changes in the city which happened, and all of them are claiming that we used to live in Europe. So this was real Europe, and we saw that everything will just rocket from that moment, and then we have a rapid break.
I have one more, and I'm not sure that you wouldn't necessarily answer it, but I'm going to try to probe your brain on that.
Mm-hmm.
As a sociologist and someone who's worked on this question for a long time, I wonder if you can say to what extent and how much value does historical memory have in the composite of identity in Ukraine? In other words, does it matter, and how much of what's happening in the narratives about history and identity in Ukraine and this remapping?
Mm-hmm.
In terms of motivating action, and this is hard stuff to do even for us political scientists, but like, to what degree would you say that in Ukrainian identity, that is a motivational factor, marker?
It's really tough question. I would say, because I conducted a lot of in-depth interviews in practically all regions of Ukraine before 2013. And for that moment, I would say that history is not really mattering. So people, if you ask them about some historical events or figures, or just to say what are the monuments or prominent figures from the city, they can tell almost nothing, or they are mixing things. Very rarely you can get more or less correct or more or less elaborated historical narrative. So I would say that at that moment history wars fought on the top, but at the bottom it was not felt at all, or practically not felt. But now we have a lot of inclusions into the history in our interviews of people who were resettled when they are talking about identity. So because of this displacement of their everyday cultures, they are encountering and new situations, and in response to this new everyday life and cultures surrounding them in new cities, they are very much included in this process of rethinking. Plus, you have very intensive process of decommunization, where names of the streets are changed, monuments disappear. And one thing, if you have a monument, you can walk and you never even notice that the one is there. But when it disappears, you, at least for some time, you are alerted that something happened, and you're starting to think about your position for this. Plus, as I said, we also have a lot of history involved in propaganda, which pushes people to think about it.
Thank you. Yes.
I do have many questions like Nagia, so I wonder whether you could expand a little bit more about the, shall we say, regional displacement of memory. I was struck, of course, by your mapping of the increase or changes in the number of monuments, let's say, to Bandera and its movement sort of eastward. I wonder whether that is a regional displacement, an ideological displacement, but actually what I'm more interested in is whether the appearance of migrants from Crimea, let's say Crimean Tatars, in places like Lviv, has led to the transport of their historical memories and reflection locally. Are there street names that have been changed to take into account their presence now, or any monuments or any particular commemorations? And that's probably the most obvious example, but perhaps there may be others from the east, you know, that may be moving westward.
If we are talking about moving east-westward, the problem is that number of people who land in western part of Ukraine is very small. For example, for Lviv Oblast altogether, these are 3,000. So if you look at the proportion of population, of course, you cannot notice this change. But if we are talking about Crimean Tatar group, they went in two big groups. One went to Lviv, mostly three, Kyiv and Kherson. These are the main, I would say, places where they went. And in those cities, they appear to be visible because they organize a lot of cultural events. They organize commemorations, and local population is also actually coming and supporting them with their commemorations. But I don't know how deep this knowledge went, because you need to conduct interviews after everything was happening, or you need to survey to see whether these are only the most educated circles who support Crimean Tatars, or whether people who are living in, you know, some remote places of the city know anything about this group or not.
Thanks. So maybe I'll jump in, and I see that there are two people more, at least, who want to ask questions. So clearly we see that there is a change in the way how people think about their past. And we know that this change is closely connected to the recent events, to Maidan and to the war in the East, to the annexation of the Crimea. We also see from these maps that there is a correlation between support for ATO and support for Maidan on the one hand, and the spread of the parts of the narrative associated with Ukrainian national history, especially in the center. But the question is, how do people learn about the past and how they start rethinking that? Again, you gave one of the examples that there was a friend who gave something to read, and we know that now there is in Ukraine there is explosion in terms of publication of the literature and history. But your interviews, do they have that component, or do they give an opportunity to learn, or at least to guess, whether it's still TV that people learn about who was Bandera and who was Lenin, or it's radio, or it's still print media, or maybe people are online now? Again, it's quite possible that the data doesn't allow to make that kind of
assumptions. So what we can trace some elements, first of all, family narratives, which start to open. Like I quoted one, but actually those resettled persons, several of them also were telling their narratives that, you know, we also were taught about this great patriotic war, and now my grandma started to tell how it was difficult to live under in this time, and how to survive, and the survival strategies we were using before we came to Ukraine when we were sheltering or so. This element, we also see intranet, a lot of intranet. So people are reading intranet and getting information, media, but first of all social media, intranet, learning from intranet. And as I said, coming to a new place, you need to know city. In some cities, like in Kherson, for example, they started to organize excursions for those. They are quite actively interacting with resettled persons. So wandering around the city, and I would say it's tourist practices as well, and learning, here is the monument, what is this monument about? And
Okay, thank you.
Thank you very much, Viktoriya, for this very, very interesting talk and presentation. If I correctly understood, it's a collective project, right? It's a huge data.
Survey was, I was part of big international team which conducted two surveys. So survey data are from this team. It was a team project when we created the questions.
Mm-hmm. So I'm a historian, so I'll take probably different a little perspective. Mm-hmm. I'm very interested on this
mental geographies and mental topographies. And I co-edited 10 years ago a book about the European lieu de mémoire. Mm-hmm. So the goal was to overpass this national lieu de mémoire and to build a kind of transnational new narrative of Europe based on shared sites of memory. So I would like to ask a question from this about this transnational issues. And I'm thinking first of all of the neighbors of Ukraine, like Poland, Romania, or Moldova, for example. So do you think that a detente between these countries could allow a recovery, I would say, of public space in cities for local or regional identities, or regional, I would say, identities that are not national? Because I was very impressed by your material, and especially I appreciated the scale you proposed: local, regional, national. Mm-hmm. What about a transnational? So, and because many of these places of memory or sites of memory mm-hmm. are shared sites of memory, Russian, Ukrainian, so, or again can be Romanian, Ukrainian, so. And if that's not happening today, how it can be achieved?
So. It is happening. I can, as you noticed in this diagram about the monuments, the other meant other minorities' memories here. But as you see, it's really on the very low scale. So these voices from margins of national minorities are gaining some places within the public spaces. But first of all, the percent of minorities in those cities are quite low. So it's very difficult to, if we are talking about democratic process, to get support and to get money and to get decision. And the other problem is that even if they appear, they still is more, this is more like a segregated memory. If we have Polish community, we would have certain monuments in Lviv, but this would be visited mostly by Polish community. And so in this case, it is very difficult to talk about really transnationalization. One of the possible themes which could be included in this transnationalization is actually Holocaust theme. But as you know, there are a lot of tensions in both official memory and local memory about this past, because it was very much silenced in the Soviet time. And now it's very gradually gaining its way, but not at that scale if we compare to, let's say, Germany, France, or other European countries.
I was thinking about a city like Odessa, for example, so it's a Jewish community and also their memories. So
yes,
so
like Dnipropetrovsk, yeah, you would get new memorials, because before there were not even memorials devoted to atrocities or to the Holocaust in Ukraine. So they are appearing, but as I said, quite often people in the city would not even know that something like this is there.
I was also thinking that maybe we are talking here about two different levels, transethnic versus transnational. And again, transethnic, that's really, I think Ukraine is in the places like Dnipropetrovsk is doing really good job, at least people on the ground, in creating these common spaces of commemoration. In terms of transnational, it seems to me that the debates over the Second World War versus Great Patriotic War are as transnational as it gets, because Ukraine in this context are either part of a one transnational space defined by the Great Patriotic War, or another transnational space defined by the May 8th and the Second World War. And that's the big part of Ukrainian story, that the conflict is not just regional within Ukraine, it's a conflict trans-European in a sense. Big chunks of Europe continue to celebrate the end of the war on different days and put very different meaning into what that war really was about, and Ukraine is right in the middle. So it's almost too much transnationality for one country. But again, thanks for your question, and sorry for abusing my powers as the moderator, Oksana.
Thank you, Viktoriya. This is really fascinating. Can I just, before I ask my question, can I say two words on this question? I think it's a really interesting question. And while I agree with what you were saying, if I understood your question correctly, you were talking about creating this sort of transnational shared kind of memory space, right, as opposed to transnational debate, because I think what you're talking about, mm-hmm. right? Mm-hmm. I mean,
shared memory. It and especially memory, I was thinking exactly. about the scale, local, regional, national,
yes.
or what beyond. So it's.
But it seems to me one important difference, and I don't know, maybe Viktoriya would disagree or others, that it seems to me that this Ukrainian debate as opposed to, say, West European debate, right? Mm-hmm. Because I think in the Ukrainian context, because Russia plays such a big role in this debate, right, I think there is a deep suspicion that maybe was not there in case between France and Germany at this point in history, right, that really sort of that there is a hidden political agenda there, right? So it's not just about sort of
this
commemorating.
Reconciliation.
Exactly, right? Which I think makes reconciliation more difficult, but I don't know, that's what I think is an interesting dimension. But Viktoriya, what I want to ask you, just two quick questions, if I may. Mm-hmm. One, which really sort of struck me as interesting, this finding that you're showing in the MAPA, how this acceptance of certain, memory positions or propositions have shifted and now incorporates Central Ukraine, right? But what I wonder, sort of, in your from your analysis, how rigid would you say this new border is, right? In other words, say the difference between Kirovohrad and Kharkiv, right? Like, I mean, for those of us who know Ukraine, like, it's not a huge difference, right? I mean, population, urban population, is still primarily speaks Russian, right? Like, rural population, often Ukrainian, Surzhik, right? Sudesnik. But there is this clear difference in attitudes, right? And we can imagine sort of a very different way of moving forward, like one. A view would be that this is just a matter of time before these new narratives and sort of this new kind of, historical myths or paradigms, whatever you want to call them, uh-huh. would just find their way kind of further east, right? Uh-huh. And another view would be that really, no, there is something sort of fundamentally different and more, I guess, stable between, this sort of larger central western part and, whatever remains in the eastern part. And really, they will not just reconcile to this new narrative, and something has to be done. So it's still essentially divided society, just the dividing line has shifted further east, right? So that would be my one question. I mean, just based with your respondents that you interviewed in these on these two sides of this new border, right? Like, how much sort of difference is there? And another just question, I just throw it in, because it's something you mentioned in your concluding remarks about the role of civil society, and I wonder if you could say a little bit more. Like, what do you mean? Like, is there a certain role civil society now plays that it didn't play before? Is there some role for civil society to play that maybe it is not playing now, because you kind of like put it on the agenda, so to say, but I don't think you have time to elaborate on it more, so I would like to hear that. Thank you.
Thank you very much for the question. I also try to look and to give some answer. So I looked at social demographic explanation or which groups would support more or less, and what we see this limiting narratives like about Bandera, about the Second World War, the Great Patriotic War. The difference is in age. So the younger people, the more willing they are to accept education and also proportion of village and city. So actually, my suspicion is, unfortunately, data doesn't allow us to look this way. But if we are talking about these outliers, if you take out big cities like Kharkiv, Odessa, which are more cosmopolitan cities, you'd get situation which would be closer to the central Ukrainian one. So this is a fact of big multicultural cities as well. And in this sense, if we see that we have this age education influence, that probably gradually the situation will be changing. To what extent? Difficult to predict. We probably need more in-depth interviews, because as I said, those which were conducted with Ukrainians, not with resettled peoples, were conducted by 2013-2014. So now it would be very interesting to see how people react into all these activities. As of civil society, from the one side, as I said, a lot of local initiatives for new commemoration cults, and this is the role of civil society, like volunteers and other groups. But what is worrying for me, this misbalance between government and local administration or local society, where government can overrule. We don't like the name of the city, but we will vote in the Supreme Council, and this will be your name of the city. And I think partially because the citizens of the localities are still in this position of bystanders, just watching. And we need an active civil society or active agents which would actually elaborate this discussion and say, let's talk, let's meet. And I know, for example, Lviv is named one of the most active from the point of view of civil society activities, but I know that the City Institute was trying to actually build up some networks, some groups for changing projects of the street or something like that. How difficult it is actually to go from few activists to the population and to change this position of bystanders. So I think, and I know that there are a number of activities, and a lot of activities actually are happening with the civic society or on those cities which are close to the in Donbass region and Luhansk, where a lot of resettled people as well. Helping people to adjust to new cities, to new locations, and also helping those cities to become much more active from the point of view of population and not coming and imposing certain visions of past or politics.
I see that there are serious repeat offenders, and that's so I guess I will start with Nadia and then we'll move back to Lubko.
Thanks. Well, I kind of want to build on that because I had a question related to some of these activities, and it struck me what you said, that you would welcome and you would hope to see more of this open public discussion, both the national and regional level. And, you know, one of the tools that one would think and used in some countries, U.S. and others, would be to provide some local funding, right, government funding to local governments to create spaces of debate or discussion, or be it certain regional programming or media where certain talks would be happening on the regional level discussing some of the difficult parts of history and kind of how to reinterpret it. So I'm wondering if there's been any move on the part of the government beside the Institute of Memory, which has been very active in creating a very radical agenda, I would argue, in terms of that top-down movement. But so when you talk about activism, where does it come from in terms of source of funding? Does it come from the government? Does it come from international organizations who are being sort of EU agencies, who are very aware of some of these painful steps or memories in Ukraine that need to be reconciled in some way?
As what I see, there are a number of initiatives both from the side of the local administration and local activists actually to develop on participatory budgeting, where a certain share of the city or village budget is giving for project calls. And then you need to set up an activist group or NGO, and you need to elaborate certain projects. And they are quite actively implemented in Lviv, Kyiv, and also, as I said, in those cities which are now like Bakhmut or some other on the. And the other very important thing is also skills to involve people. So there are a number of conferences and projects which are going on working or teaching how to involve people in this participatory practices in their localities. Because quite often, even if you have money, but if people are not used to say something, what they want, they don't have practice of doing this, of changing things, then of course you need also people who know how to facilitate this process.
And who funds these workshops or?
A lot of, I know Bjolf Foundation, but if you need, I can give you in touch with.
Whether it's you know, domestically funded, or whether this is like an external actor.
Both.
In this case, EU funding or some mm-hmm. others coming in and sort of turning to history as a way of.
Both.
Yeah. I have some comments and questions sort of interlinked, stimulated by the last two or three. Question starting with Stelis about the transnational, so to speak, possibilities. I think when we should perhaps distinguish between possibilities or impossibilities provided between historical events and historical individuals. I think it's very hard to find a kind of a transnational, trans-ethnic common ground to commemorate in Lviv, never mind World War II or Ukrainian-Russian relations, but the cemetery of the Orlata in Lviv, the Polish defenders of Lviv in 1918, versus from the defenders from Ukraine and the Ukrainian defenders from the Poles, the Ukrainska Halicka Armia. So that is a little difficult to reconcile. I suppose there are, you know, maybe mechanical ways to do it. I saw something rather peculiar in 2009 when I had the good fortune to be taken down to Odessa for the reopening of the renovated opera house, which had been closed for many years. And the person who brought me there showed me the monument of Catherine the Second, or Catherine the Great, which had been dismantled before and was now going to be brought back, but it was not yet unveiled. So it was covered. And what was it covered by? It was covered by a blue and yellow Ukrainian national flag, which I thought was, you know, perhaps an interesting combination, but I'm not sure that that is exactly the kind of, you know, reconciliation one would have in mind. However, one can think of individuals who might be able to fulfill that function. I can think of General Grigorenko, who was a hero of the Soviet military of the World War II. He was interred in Mount Brook in New Jersey, wrapped in a blue and yellow flag, still in the Soviet period. And he is at the same time a hero of the Crimean Tatars, whose interests he had defended. Or there is the historian Lipinski, who was ethnically a Pole and a Roman Catholic, but you know, one of the most original political thinkers of Ukraine. Or one can think of Jabotinsky, of course, the or Arnold Margolin, a Jewish, you know, activist and historical figures, who at the same time were supporters of Ukrainian independence at a time when Ukrainian cause had very little international recognition. So I'm wondering, are there any discussions of such individuals? I believe that Reorenko has been mentioned, maybe, I think. Rezak, maybe, I think, mentions him as a possible uniting figure, but not the others.
No.
I think
maybe
there are possibilities
in some
there.
Intellectual circles, but my focus was on more or less presidential official discourse. No. There. His focus is on ATO.
If I can add something in terms of the limitations of these projects, we were talking about how wonderful all of that is. And Viktoriya mentioned that you remove cities and the picture emerges very different. And that's basically true, and this is one of the problems of maps in general, maps constructed as adjacent polygons, which are colored in a certain color. We found that when we were working on the famine module, and it's one picture when you cover the entire huge region. When you go to the rayon level, and there were 400 rayon levels, the picture emerges very different. And again, here it's probably the best representation would be a big city and proximity to a big city. And it's a big city, over 500,000 or 1,000,000, that comes with a certain set of historical memories, culture, linguistic culture, and otherwise. We were one of things where we were trying to figure out what was going on was that there is a huge difference in terms of this response to the Ukrainian national narrative in the Ukrainian parts of Luhansk Oblast on the one hand and Donetsk Oblast on the other. And Luhansk parts are actually on par, maybe in terms of their attitude toward historical events and commemoration practices and things like that, maybe on par with Poltava. Maybe I'm stretching, but more like a center. And the Ukrainian parts of Donetsk Oblast are very different. And again, one of our possible explanations that has to be tested is that in Luhansk part there is Mariupol, the city of more than 500,000 people, where there is actually the Luhansk part is rural. And again, there can be other explanations as well, but again, the big city really changes the image and dynamic, and the way how we represent it and generally how it is represented as polygons. You have to go probably on a certain level, just beyond the level of oblasts, to find out what is going on. We started doing that now with Donetsk and Luhansk oblasts being divided. We have no choice. Mm-hmm. We have to do that, and that's where we also find things that we didn't expect to find before. Mm-hmm. Yes, Alexander.
To ask a question about something that you haven't mentioned in your presentation, as far as I can remember, but I think it's there because you cannot reconsider the past without the narrative, right? About certain memories. And the question is, what is the language of those narratives? Is language a factor in any of those reconstruction of the past when you conduct your interviews? What is the language that is used by those people? Is there any correlation between use of Russian or Ukrainian? I know you probably will say that it's usually correlation between the city and the village is more important, but there are also small cities, right? So have you counted how many interviews were in Russian, in Ukrainian, or it doesn't matter for your research?
For in-depth interviews, we cannot use statistics in this way. Mm-hmm. So majority of, if we are talking about interviews with resettled people, majority of them, they were in Russian, but the methodology was, it depends which language he or she chooses. And then it is conducted either in Ukrainian or in Russian. We have several in Ukrainian, but majority of them would be in Lviv. But as I said, if we are talking about in-depth interviews and you have only 100 in-depth interviews, this is not, we cannot talk about any relationship. As of the survey of data, I looking for doing my research, I looked also for social demographic explanations, and in some cases language matters, but these are those Ukrainian nationalized versions of past, like if we are talking about Bandera or we are talking about the particular perception of the Second World War, then yes. If we are talking about this historical figures on elements of narrative which are presented more widely, then language doesn't matter.
So I don't know if I have a question. I've been thinking a lot about this myself and also presented at ESSEs. about how all of this is kind of reflected in literary works in particular. And kind of the main finding is that people very much, so kind of regular people, very much understand that to a large extent this is a smokescreen for the government, and kind of their impression is that the government doesn't care that much about reconciliation. And so kind of, and that kind of the next question is always to ask, why was it done in the way that it was done? And I've been reading a lot about kind of behavior science experiments, and there was one experiment that particularly caught my attention. Participants were asked to participate in an experiment, and as a result, they would have ability to choose between two objects as per the location. So when they were presented with both choices, more or less 50% selected one or the other. And so that was a coffee mug and a chocolate bar. However, if they were only given one option in the beginning, let's say chocolate bar or coffee mug, and only later presented with the second option, they would have a very hard time giving up something that they already have, you know, kind of possessed in a way. And so there's a lot of discussion about why is that done and so on and so forth. But kind of for our discussion, I think what is really important is to realize that even if it's something that maybe belongs to this symbolic sphere of the empire or the kind of the colonizing power and so on, it's very hard to just impose something on people without meeting resistance. And so one of the kind of concerns that I see in this is precisely what you have voiced here using data, is that the government really is imposing a certain narrative that they think is correct, justified, given the moment and so on, but they don't care for this long-term effort to really kind of create a reconciliation within the society, because long-term efforts are much, much harder to capitalize on, politically speaking, right? It's very easy to kind of push something through as a not very well-designed package of laws, and then, you know, stand and say, I'm fighting for Ukraine's, the abolishing of Ukraine's victimhood, or kind of reconstituting a certain sense of Eastern, like the kind of this upstanding truth. And so the kind of the, is it also your, I guess, is it also your impression that much more of these efforts are understood among the population, the people that you were surveyed, as you know, done for political profit rather than you know, for some kind of morally motivated justice and such concepts?
I think that management theory says that actually any innovation is hard, and you always have resistance to any type of innovation. And one of the ways, as it is written in management theory, to at least partially overcome this resistance is to delegate power to the group. And then you can say, this is not only me who is imposing this, but this is, even if your power is greater and still the choice is on you, but still you can use this to reduce resistance. And this is why I'm saying that civil society is very important. We need to give a space for the public discussion. We need to give a space, and then we can reduce level of resistance, if we need to reduce it as well.
So if I can just follow up on that. So there's one example, I think, that is very striking in this entire story. In Western Ukraine, as we know, kind of all this renaming and removing of a lot of the symbols kind of happened on its own very soon after 1991. I know from my own city of Ternopil that very quickly this monument disappeared, streets were renamed, etc. So there was one case in this recent decommunization effort of Komsomolsk na Dnipri. Right? It's a kind of the regional center in Poltava, in the Poltava region, that was given time to construct its own name, its own identity, so to speak. there were meetings indeed held by the local authorities, inviting people to come and discuss, etc. People flat out rejected the whole effort. And so we don't want to rename, etc. So there was some kind of simulacra that were created when each letter stood for something else, etc., etc. So a lot of these kind of possibilities to keep. And the main motivation was not so much about the Komsomol, but about the fact that it was considered a city or a town, kind of more than a village. And the result was that after they stole for so long, etc., according to the law, the Verkhovna Rada, the high council, basically renamed it into Horishny Plavny, which was one of the villages on the territory of that city. And so precisely kind of this, the lack of ability for the local communities to participate in this is evidenced in this particular case. And so to me, it tells that what you need is a long-term campaign of education, a long-term campaign of explaining why that name symbolizes something, and if we are in some kind of anti-colonial struggle, what does it mean for that struggle, right? And what does it mean for us and our identity? But of course, you don't see such efforts on the part of the government.
Yes, because you claim you are overcoming Soviet practices, but actually imposing from above certain names.
Yes.
This is actually typical Soviet
practice.
So it's done in the way they are pretending to fighting with.
But it seems like to build a new memory, a new narrative, but the method is very old. So in fact, we're replacing the memories from Soviet, imperial, etc., with the same, we know how much it can be also artificially, to build this national heroes, national sites of memories, national monuments. So it's a very, very old, method. So it's something new, but with the kind of old tools, old instruments.
But
so it's.
But I don't even think I don't even think they offer anything new at this point. That's the problem.
Mm-hmm.
Because if something new were offered, I can imagine a marketing campaign, right, where you kind of come to the city, you offer activities to kind of identify with this part of the city's or the region's history. But that is not even offered. That's the problem. So it just stamped. And period, and that's I see why a lot of kind of local elites are becoming very disenchanted with the post-Maidan government and the kind of the practices that are employed.
But at the same time, if we look at this, I actually looked at quite some detail how this debate went on in Kharkiv, right? It was actually even more perverse, if you can say that, right? Because the law does provide for this local discussion, right? And the city local authorities are supposed to call these громadskie sluchania, like public hearings, right? And sometimes, in case when the authorities themselves were ideologically motivated, right? Like this whole Dzerzhinsky brother and whatever, so they would call a public hearing, but would keep it secret from the public, and would actually fill the hearing hall with like civil servants who were just supposed to vote for whatever the mayor decided, right?
Mm-hmm.
Like, or the law. So it's like even if an institutional mechanism is there, because if you look at the letter of the law, it's not completely ridiculous. There is always a time to discuss, But not only, oftentimes civil society was unprepared. The local authorities who opposed it for whatever reason, use these institutional tools, kind of twisted them, to have their way. And then in the end, I think it's fair to say what everybody was saying, that there was in some sense, like Soviet methods were in place, right? But on the other hand, and this is maybe what, the National Institute of Memory is counting on, the people eventually just get used to it, right? Since this Horishny Plavny, we renamed Horishny Plavny, it's not that we have some mass protest against it, right? People just sort of like accept that the new reality and they go about their daily life, and if before they lived on, Sherbitsky Street and now it's Mazepa Street, like for 2 weeks they were sort of scratching their head and then it just becomes a new routine, right?
So
and maybe that's what they're
talking about. Is an interesting example because there is a whole movement in that city going on kind of opposing the renaming, mm-hmm. because they feel like they've been reduced to a village now. Mm-hmm. That, and I think that's more important to them than, you know, being
but
or someone.
I think there are also some like grassroots initiatives to publicize Gorizia Slavni as this great like tourist destination and whatever else. So it's a complicated story going on there. You know, I've seen like, you know, that they're trying to organize tours to this, like,
yeah,
you know. But yeah, but you're right. I mean, there it's all about this urban thing, that we're not some
yeah.
sort of village, right?
Yeah,
we are
exactly.
This, like,
yeah,
exactly.
Exactly.
So
that
was not even considered.
Yeah.
Like the flatness of the law
right,
shows,
right, right.
The one-dimensionality
yeah.
shows that
mm-hmm.
they did not even consider these possibilities.
Right.
Of, you know,
and the thing was also is missing in this whole discussion, and I don't know, Viktoriya, if that came out in your research, because we are sort of, I mean, it seems like it's almost there is an assumption there that there is some sort of neutral starting point. But we are not having a neutral starting point, right? Because whatever this memory landscape that we had was something that was imposed by the Soviet state. Like nobody
mm-hmm.
asked if people want to have a monument to Lenin, like at every street corner and like 20 streets named after Marx, right? So in a way, I mean, and I think that gives ammunition to the Viktorovich and, you know, others who want to sort of, with revolutionary methods, change that, because they say that was not an outcome of some sort of public discussion or, you know, civil society activism. There was sort of the Soviet imposition, and now we're going to change that, and we're going to do it, like, in a little bit more democratic way. Here is your public hearing that, you know, nobody is taking advantage of, and then too bad, and here is your new name, right?
Mm.
So I think it's a very complicated story, and it would be interesting, I mean, to see exactly in these, you know, it's like this sort of this new borderland that you...
Actually, there are
five very
mm. interesting movies, documentary movies, shot by the School of Journalism of Ukrainian Catholic University,
mm-hmm.
and some of them are actually taking place in these small cities.
Mm-hmm.
It's like 10 minutes long and with
mm-hmm.
very complicated stories.
Yeah.
So I would really advise to.
I've seen some of, there was this like live YouTube feed from some of these meetings. I actually watched some, and it's really fascinating because you have this very
mm-hmm.
passionate, like a few very passionate people, some like old communists who will say that like Lenin, наше все, right?
Uh-huh.
And then some sort of Azov people who are like, we're gonna kick you out together with your Lenin, right? And then this sort of like general public officials who are kind of like don't know what to do about it, and they basically, as you say, there is no marketing, like it's not that they can propose something, they sort of cautious about these two extreme positions, but they don't have anything else to offer, right?
There is marketing, but of a different kind.
Yeah.
Or in West Ukraine, in small cities, they are having one cultural house, they have two choirs,
mm-hmm.
one old boys who are singing Soviet songs, and old ladies singing UPA songs. And they are constantly in quarrel.
And unfortunately, we are completely out of time. Again, it was a very interesting discussion. I was thinking about Horishny Plavny. At the end of the day, it's urban versus
mm-hmm.
rural identity that became the key, and not the question of national identity that we pay so much attention to. At least
mm-hmm.
those two are somehow interconnected and interrelated. So there were more questions, it looks like, than we had time to answer. So I'm sure we'll continue this discussion in a few weeks once we launch the actually working module, the working module of history and memory in contemporary Ukraine. So thanks a lot. And I invite all of you to our next seminar on Monday. Dominique Carrel will be talking on the Maidan and the collapse of support for President Yanukovych during those days, and again, spatial element will be a very important part of his presentation. So thank you. I know. I told Tamara, well, some people have to work. What can you do?
Добрий день. Interesting how all that. So you should do whatever you can to publish.
Horrendous.